Independence is brought to you by Pioneer Public Television. The next hour is intended to encourage debate and educate you, the voter, about the candidates running for office. The end result is for voters to be able to make an informed decision on Election Day. Participate in the process by sending in your questions now. Up next are the candidates for House District 12A, Jay McNamar from Elbow Lake and Jeff Backer from Browns Valley.
Welcome to Pioneer Public Television's Meet the Candidates. My name is Amy Dahl Wallers, and I will be the moderator for tonight's program. The goal of this program is to get you to learn who your candidates are and hopefully to motivate you to vote on November 4th. Tonight we have candidates that are running for the House District 12A seat. Let's meet those candidates. First, we have Jay McNamar from Elbow Lake, the Democrat. Welcome, Jay.
Thank you for having me here tonight, Amy. I appreciate that.
Sure. And next we have Jeff Backer, Republican from Browns Valley. Welcome.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for inviting us here tonight.
Sure. Now let's take a look at the map for House District 12A so that you can see if this is your voting area.
Minnesota State House District 12A includes the counties of Wilken, Traverse, Big Stone, Grant, and Stevens. It also includes parts of Douglas and Pope counties, as well as the cities of Morris, Breckenridge, Elbow Lake, and Ortonville, to name a few.
If this is your district, I encourage you to call in with your questions this evening. Please be aware that we will give preference to questions that are asked of both candidates instead of questions that are directed to a single candidate. We will begin with a 3-minute opening remark from both of the candidates, and then we'll take a short break while we take your calls and prepare them for the candidates. And starting with the opening remarks this evening is Jeff Backer. Jeff?
Yes, thank you for everybody that's watching tonight. I want to thank Pioneer TV for having this. Thank you, Jay, for also being here. To give you a little background, I am a small business owner in our community with my identical twin brother. I've been a business owner for 24 years. Also have served as mayor of Browns Valley. Currently, I serve as a school board of our community on our school board in Browns Valley. Along with, I have volunteered 18 years as an EMT for our community. One of the things that I've been hearing door knocking throughout the district, from up to Elbow Lake, Ashby, down to Ortonville, Odessa, to Beardsley, and into Starbuck, is that we need to grow jobs in our rural economy instead of taxes. We have a lot of people who are working hard. In the last 2 years, we've seen an increase in the state budget of 12%. Where on the average, we've only seen an increase in most people's income of 3%. And I know several people who haven't seen that. We're working hard, and we need a state government that works with us and not against us. Also, things that I'm hearing about is people are concerned about their insurance. You know, I was at a door of a gentleman in Ortonville, and that was the first thing that he came up. It was exactly a week ago, and he was concerned about how MenSure and Obamacare and these new the insurance is going to affect his kids. And basically his thing was is that, you know, we're only going to be able to use it at a very catastrophe or something like that. So I'm hearing those type of concerns. Also, I'm hearing that people are concerned about a one-party rule. As we know, business owners, housewives, individuals, teachers, it's nice to have the balance. And right now at state government, we don't have that balance. And we need that balance just to have good debate and to get the best out of the system and so forth. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. And next, Jay McNamar, you may give your opening statement.
I'd like to thank Pioneer Public Television for having us on tonight. I appreciate that. It's an honor to be here. I am Representative Jay McNamar. I was born and raised in western Minnesota and have lived in Minnesota all of my life. I graduated from high school in Ada, Minnesota, and earned a Bachelor of Science degree from the University of North Dakota, Ellendale. My wife and I moved to Elbow Lake, where I taught and coached for 36 years. We have 2 daughters and 4 grandchildren. After I retired from teaching, my neighbor, Helen Swenson, and a good friend, Dick Grout, encouraged me to run for mayor of Elbow Lake. I took on the challenge and was elected in 2008. While I was mayor, our city, like many other cities in Minnesota, was unallotted local government aid several times to balance the state budget. We reached the point of either reducing basic services, cutting employees or raising our property taxes, and I wasn't going to do any of those options. We passed a referendum for our local school to provide funds to allow the school to operate. It was not good enough. Our school had to borrow money to make it through the year because the state took money from our school to balance the state budget and change how it provided funding. Almost every day the past 4 years, I've gone to our local nursing home and visited my mother. Our nursing home was having trouble keeping staff because nursing home staff had not been given a raise in 4 years, and their employees were looking for better paying jobs. Why? Because the state was not funding nursing homes to balance the state budget. I decided I could help my community most by running for the state legislature and restoring what had been taken from us. I campaigned to pay back the schools, fund nursing homes, increase local government aid, and lower our property taxes that had risen because funding hadn't been provided for programs and our property taxes had to take its place. In the past 2 years, I've been extremely proud to have been part of paying back our schools, giving funding to our nursing homes, increasing local government aid, and finally starting to lower our property taxes while balancing the state budget on time without tricks or gimmicks. However, we cannot be satisfied with what we have accomplished, because we have much more to do, such as continuing to improve our economy, finding a permanent means of funding transportation, growing our middle class. Now, we must also continue funding our schools, nursing homes, our local governments, and reducing our property taxes. It's a big task. It's possible to be done as long as our legislators keep working together.
If you would like to call in with questions for the candidates, please call us now at 1-800-726-3178 or email your questions to yourtv@pioneer.org. And we will take a 3-minute break and listen to a message from Pioneer Public Television to give you an opportunity to send in your questions. Thank you.
Thanks for watching Meet the Candidates on Pioneer Public Television. After this short break, we will return to the question and answer portion. We encourage you to call in or send your questions by email to the studio for the candidates to address.
I'm Gwen Ifill. Join me each week on Washington Week. It's your one stop for insightful news analysis by a roundtable of award-winning journalists. Count on Washington Week to go beyond the headlines to explain how the world affects your life.
What if TV respected children?
They long to know that they're loved.
And taught children respect. Who says everybody can't master French cooking?
Bon appétit!
Why can't TV encourage millions of preschoolers to learn? All of us to wonder. And a nation to experience history as it was lived.
The dream shall never die.
And what if great art flowed into every living room freely? Give to your PBS station and support the people and programs that never stop asking, what if?
Am I ever glad to be in this neighborhood?
The fact that PBS is the most trusted media outlet in the country means a great deal to me. We live now in the most multicultural, multiracial, multi-ethnic America ever. There are a lot of voices in this country that need to be heard. And I think that my job is to help Americans re-examine the assumptions that they hold, to expand their inventory of ideas, and hopefully to introduce Americans to each other. And we take that challenge seriously every day.
There's no program like the PBS NewsHour. It's been on the air for more than 3 decades.
The NewsHour is always going to take you deeper and take you broader. That's even more essential now than I think it ever was.
Now, what we're able to do is to take it to the next step, to coordinate even more closely with what we're doing online.
And we're finally in the position where we can expand our franchise to the weekend as well.
PBS NewsHour Weekend is kind of a natural evolution for the Monday to Friday program.
The world is more complicated than it's ever been. People have more access to sources of news than they've ever had.
And what the NewsHour does is it tells you not only what happened that day, it digs a little deeper.
Night after night, 7 days a week, we're consistently different than what the audiences get on broadcast television.
There has to be a destination where you can get the information, and it's still going to take you someplace you didn't even know you wanted to go.
That's the NewsHour.
We return now to our question and answer portion of the program. We encourage you to become involved by sending in your questions by phone or email.
Welcome back. We've received some questions during the break, and you are encouraged to continue to call in or email your questions. Gentlemen, we'll now start, and you each get 2 minutes to answer each question. You're entitled to up to a one-minute rebuttal if you'd like the rebuttal. Now, we've had a couple questions come in about transit, and I will just use one of the questions. The Minnesota legislature may approve state funding for the green and blue line light rail extensions in the next session. If given the choice, how would you vote?
You know, down in that metropolitan area, there is a lot of congestion, a lot of traffic. As a matter of fact, when I'm down there, I don't like to drive, especially at night, because I get mixed up sometimes. And mass transit is a good way of getting people all over. And from what I see, you can go from the state capitol down to the airport and back again. It keeps congestion off the streets, keeps people like me from having an accident, but it's also a cheap way of moving people around. We don't have light rail or mass transit out here. It'd be something we'd need to have. In the future, it'll probably come about. You know what? I'd probably support mass transit.
All right. Jeff?
Well, unfortunately, Greater Minnesota has not received the amount of funding that we should. You know, we have farther distance from more distance to travel out in this area than we see in the metro area going from point A to point B. And historically, over the years, especially the last couple of years, we have seen a decrease in priority and funding out in rural Minnesota. And as elected as a representative, my focus would be is to get more of a balance out here. It's this part of the state that feeds the metro area. We need both, and we need transportation for the small business owner, for the farmers. That's how they get their product to the market. So my focus would be the focus of the district, and that would be focusing on increasing or just get equal funding like other parts of the state does because of all the distance that we have to travel for our function schools and other events, including business and so forth. So my focus would be getting to get the funding for rural Minnesota, equal funding, and that's where it would be the most effective use of our current legislative dollars.
Jay, would you like a rebuttal?
You bet. We don't have mass transit. We don't have light rail. What we need to do is invest in our highways and our roads. That's how we get around. That's how we get our product to market. Transportation funding for Greater Minnesota is of great importance, especially in our agricultural area.
Jeff, would you like a rebuttal?
No, I don't.
Okay.
No, we're good.
All right, then, here we go. Next question, and Jeff, we will start with you, and this is a question on broadband. The state has just announced that they are accepting applications for the border-to-border broadband program. Do you believe there are additional opportunities in which the state could assist in lowering the costs associated with broadband expansion?
You know, broadband expansion is very important in our area, especially with myself and my twin brother. We employ 14 people, and we're an internet business, and if it wasn't for the broadband that we have in Browns Valley, we would not be able to live and function. So broadband is extremely important. You know, what they're doing in Big Stone County right now makes sense. They're teaming up with a local provider to look at and apply for the grant to enhance broadband out into the rural districts, into the townships. And that's an important economic vehicle. We've seen that done in South Dakota. South Dakota has been very effective. And in Minnesota, we need to do the same. We need to provide tax benefits for the businesses who take that risk, because in the long run, the state will benefit. That's something that's very, very beneficial, is when the state can partner with private enterprise and enhance service, then what's going to happen is we have a greater chance of keeping our greatest resource. And our greatest resource in rural Minnesota is our people. And unfortunately, we're losing them to North Dakota and South Dakota because we don't have the benefits to keep them here, the tax structure to allow them to be successful entrepreneurs.
Thank you, Jeff. Jay?
The border-to-border broadband bill I was part of, I was a co-author on it, and you're exactly right. We need broadband internet all through, especially our area. We have some poor broadband areas towards the western part of our state. And what we need it for is this. We need it for business, for our businesses, for our farmers, for our education. The matching grant we have is a good opportunity for local governments to pair with private industry to fund broadband through our whole area. Now, we've asked for $100 million. We didn't get that. We got $20 million. And we're giving out grants up to $5 million per matching grant. We'll give out four per year. When those four grants are given out, when that $20 million is going to get given out, we're going to do it again until we get the whole state full of broadband. Gigazone, Bemidji, had a great area where they just put in a huge amount of broadband, and they expect to have their area full of businesses because people now will have access to their broadband internet.
Thank you.
Yeah, we also need tax subsidies. Allow businesses, give them tax breaks to take the risk. And I understand that in the one of the bills that there was is that you voted against that, Jay, to allow tax benefits for businesses. And I think whenever we can pair government with private businesses, can pair with the two, not just with the grant program, but give them tax incentives to expand, similar to what we saw in rural electrification. I think it's a win-win-win situation. We can keep people here.
I agree.
Okay. All right, Jay, the next question, starting with you. What are your top three priorities when elected or reelected in November?
Keep funding our schools. I tell you what, we're recovering from this past recession faster than any other state in the nation. And according to our retired economist, Tom Stinson, the reason we're doing so well, so fast, is because we have an outstanding educational system. We funded heavily into it last session, and we can't quit. Education is the key for Minnesota to keep its top ranking in everything. My second priority, nursing homes. We need to keep funding our nursing homes. In rural Minnesota, nursing homes not only have a place for our loved ones, but they also are one of our top employers in a lot of our small communities. We need to keep those nursing homes open. We need to keep those people employed. And the third thing, find a substantial permanent funding for transportation, because in greater Minnesota, roads and highways is how we get around and how we get our product to market. Funding our schools, funding nursing homes, finding substantial and permanent transportation funding.
Thank you. Jeff?
Number one would be to businesses and keep people in our area. You know, unfortunately, if we go from Canada down to Iowa, there is a majority of the communities on the North Dakota and South Dakota side are bigger. Unfortunately, Minnesota is the third largest income tax state behind California and Oregon. Percentage-wise, income tax, where South Dakota is zero and North Dakota is 3.22% right now. We need to keep our best resource in this area, and that is individuals. That is our families, and that is so important. And what we've seen with the tax, $2.1 billion tax increases here in the last 2 years, it doesn't do it. You know, state government has raised by 12%. people have not. And we need to have that balanced approach. We need to attract, keep people in our area by allowing them to be successful in what they're doing. Two, education. As a school board member, we need to get more control at the local school board and not a one policy fit all approach, a metro approach. And then number three, we need to support our seniors. As an EMT, I've been in the nursing homes. I go into nursing homes quite frequently to help patients, unfortunately take them to hospital when they need it and so forth. So we do need to fund our seniors. And I'm going to throw in a fourth thing. We need to support our veterans. One thing that we need to do that was not passed last year by the DFL legislative is giving tax incentives to business owners who hire veterans. These people have served the country and they need to, we need to help them to get back into the community once they serve our area.
All right, Jeff, we have a couple questions because we are a border state, border area out here. So we've got a couple questions about border questions, and I'll go with this one. What can be done to improve the business climate and remain competitive for border towns? And we're starting with Jeff.
You know, one of the things I talked about in the last time, and being a small business owner, I understand the difficulty of running a business in Minnesota. I have the business experience that my opponent does not have. And one of the things I said in the last question is, Minnesota has the third highest income percentage in the state, in the country, followed by California and Oregon. That makes it very difficult. We have regulations that are very difficult. We have a farm in Stevens County who has was turned down by the Minnesota Pollution Agency on a permit. Regulations, I know businesses that have moved, the last time I ran, for a Senate position, I knew a business that started a hog operation in North Dakota instead of Clay County. This provides income in our community, and these are responsible business people. So as long as we have more regulations in Minnesota, which we are not a regulation poor state, and my opponent and the DFL legislative has passed more regulations in the last 2 years, and tax increases, $2.1 billion. Yes, they gave $400 million back. That's like if you give me a dollar, I give you 25 cents back, and I call that as a tax cut. That's not a tax cut. The fact is we are working harder, and we're not seeing the benefits because we have a state government that's not working with us. They're working against us. So we need to look at reducing regulations responsibly. We also need to look at to balance the tax equation because we're losing our best resource, and that's people. We're losing it to the Dakotas.
Thank you.
Border city help is very important. There are some incentives that we should be giving to our businesses to keep them competitive with the states in North Dakota and South Dakota. Keeping our taxes competitive is important so we don't have people moving from our cities to North Dakota and South Dakota cities. Nursing homes are having trouble. Nursing homes, especially on the borders of North Dakota. And that's because they have trouble paying the wages that North Dakota can pay. We've got to be able to fund and help those businesses and those taxpayers in those border cities be competitive with their states right across the border. And we've done that. And we've had border city bills that have passed to help them out. I think that's what I got.
All right. Next question.
I get a rebuttal.
Would you like a rebuttal?
Yeah, sure.
Certainly you can have a rebuttal.
You know, I've been door knocking in the district, and the sad fact is in border communities, they have, on the Minnesota side, we have more vacant homes than on the North Dakota side. And, you know, one of the things that you voted for, Jay, in H.R. 2543 in the amendment was you voted in favor of more government regulations that would make it more difficult for small businesses to start and grow. South Dakota and North Dakota wants businesses. We need not to be exporting our greatest resource. And as a representative, I will be supporting individual small businesses, if it's a one person, two person, three person, because as we grow, as the business environment grows, that gives more tax revenue for the state. We need our greatest resources to stay, and that's people and entrepreneurs.
You know, it's interesting you're talking about door knocking, and I door knock too. And I found there's been a number of families that moved to Minnesota from North Dakota. And why? Because Minnesota has a better lifestyle. We have housing that's more accessible. And you know what? We have a good state. It's a good place to live and raise a family and retire in.
Thank you. Jay, small cities in west central Minnesota without tax wealth receive local aid for basics such as fire, water, and sewer. Do you believe Minneapolis and St. Paul should also be receiving local government aid?
Local government aid also, like we do. And you know what? Local government aid should be given more to us than them. Our tax base is extremely small compared to the metropolitan area. But you know what? What's fair is fair. Local government aid is generated by the sales tax on merchandise sold in our state. And you know what? We don't sell quite as much as the metropolitan area, but we deserve a good share of that. You know why? Because it gives us the chance to have the same things that other communities have, such as safe streets, good police control. We have the arts. Local government aid is a good thing.
Thank you. Jeff?
You know, local government aid was intended for providing those essential services that we see in our small communities. We have 42 communities, incorporated or unincorporated, in our state, in 12A, excuse me. And local government aid, as mayor, I know the importance of local government aid. We do not, in our district, unfortunately, because we're exporting businesses into North Dakota and South Dakota and individuals at a greater percentage than what's coming in and so forth, it was not intended for Minneapolis, St. Paul, St. Cloud, Rochester, because they have the tax capacity that we do not have. And so local government aid is important, but to give it to Minneapolis, St. Paul, and Duluth, along with St. Cloud, Rochester, no, that doesn't make sense. And as a legislator, we have to look at reforming that formula to what its original intent was. We work a lot. I know a lot of rural legislators work a lot in the metro and suburban. We have to do the same here. It's the rural area that feeds the metro area. So I do support LGA, but I do not support LGA for Minneapolis, St. Paul, and the other communities that have the tax capacity that we don't have out here.
Jay, would you like a rebuttal?
No.
All right. Okay, the next question, we had a couple questions about the new minimum wage. To paraphrase, we have some business owners that are concerned that the new minimum wage is going to harm them economically. Can you help business owners? Jeff?
You know, I believe in maximum wage. And how you achieve maximum wage, instead of just looking at minimum wages, we have to create a better business environment. You know, in the last 2 years with the Dayton tax increase and the DFL tax increase of $2.1 billion, we saw a tax increase on the farmers, we saw a tax proposed for the warehouse, for business to business. That does not allow us business owners to reward people for their efforts because we have someone taking from our pocket, and that's the state government. North Dakota, South Dakota, they get it. They understand if they partner with the small business owners, if it's a sole proprietorship, 2, 3, 4 people, or whatever that number is, I'm talking small businesses up to 49 people, because that is what makes the bulk of our district. And when I refer to small businesses, I'm also talking about farmers. But what it does allow us to do, we need maximum wage, and to do that, we need to create a climate, because government cannot create jobs. There's people that thinks that government can create jobs. They cannot. What can be done is government can create an environment to allow people to flourish as an entrepreneur or as a one person. I mean, just look at the business-to-business taxes that was collected from small businesses working within our community. That took money out so we couldn't focus on better wages, and instead of creating a mandate from the top down, and we have to allow business owners to do it. And I've met several business owners in our area. They want their staff members to succeed. And, I mean, they work hard to help the people that work with them alongside of them. So I'm in favor of maximum wage, and that's in growing our business climate so we can offer more and so forth.
Thank you. Jay?
Minimum wage. We have 350,000 people who will benefit from an increase in minimum wage up to $9.50 an hour. 350,000 people. If you increase your wage by $1, that's $350,000 more dollars in 1 hour. That's $2.5 million in 1 day. That's about $12 million in 1 week. In 1 year, rounding up, that's $600 million. Those are the people that need to spend the money. That money goes directly into our economy. That money is spendable income. $1 spent in our economy, $1 spent in our environment, in our local business area, is passed around 4 to 8 times. That minimum wage, you know what it does? I don't call it a minimum wage. I call it a stimulus. And it's going to increase more businesses. It's going to give more people a chance to work more. Minimum wage is a great thing. And you know what? I'm glad we passed.
And that's the difference between me and Jay. I mean, the key thing is a government approach compared to a private enterprise approach. We as business owners understand how to grow our businesses and be more successful. But when you have government in your back pocket saying, you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this, it disincentivizes people to come into business and so forth. So it's, again, the government knows more than what we do, and it's not the case. We as local individuals, small business owners, families, and farmers understand more than St. Paul, the metro area does, and that's where we're different. I will represent this area and bring the values of this area down there instead of the metro area.
Jay?
Money generates business. If there's no money in the economy, there will be no business growth. By putting extra money in the economy, we will generate more jobs. And that's what we've done in the legislature this past year. We generated more money, more income. And if you go down Main Street right now and you take a look, if you go to Alexandria, if you go to Elbow Lake, there's signs all over saying, now hiring. The reason we're hiring, because we've got more money in our economy, there's more money to spend, there's more money for jobs. You know what? Jobs are important, but they do not form on their own. There has to be spendable income there for them to develop.
Thank you. Jay, are there any specific programs, taxes, or laws that you would eliminate?
That I would eliminate? Boy, I tell you what, that's a tough question. So, you know, there is a program that was eliminated that I'd like to reinstate. And it has to do with people who are picked up while driving for minor violations. And what happened is this, is that our counties were putting what was a driver education. You could go, if you got picked up for a minor violation such as rolling through a stop sign or speeding 5 miles an hour over the speed limit, you could go to the county or to the local law enforcement. You could take a class for 2-3 days. You could get that class, make you a better driver, make you a safer driver, and you could get that violation suspended. You'd have to pay for the class, but it wouldn't go on your driving record. You know, I don't know if I'm answering the question right or not. There are some things that should be reinstated. That's one of them that's good for our communities.
Sorry about that.
That's all right. Jeff?
One of the programs that we need to eliminate is MNsure. That has been a disaster. I've talked to families, just like I mentioned in my opening with the gentleman in Ortonville. He was concerned about his children and grandchildren getting insurance. That program has done nothing. A one-size metro approach program does nothing for us in rural Minnesota. We're seeing costs increase, not to families, we're seeing costs increase to Minnesota, and the program was so bad that they pumped in $400 million into it, and we didn't hear hardly anything of it. And then we had the greatest provider who just walked out of it. That program, we had a good did we have the best program in the world before Minsure with MinCare? And no, we didn't. But it was a heck of a lot better than what we had now. One approach does not work. Businesses understand that, and families understand that. You cannot raise in a family one child exactly like the other child. We know that because they're gifted uniquely, and you want to foster that. Well, having a one-approach Minnesota insurance or one insurance with MinSure or Obamacare, however you want to call it, or Affordable Care Act, which is really anti-Affordable Care Act, because my insurance premiums have not gone down and the people I've talked to haven't. But you need a program that gives people choices. Again, that's how you grow economy. You don't grow economy by saying, I'm raising your wage and I'm putting a dollar more in the economy. You raise long-term growth by allowing our best resources, families, individuals who want to stay here and work and take that risk. So I would get rid of MinSure right away and decrease the taxes that we saw in the last 2 years, because that's taking money out of our district and sending it other places.
Jay, would you like a rebuttal?
MinSure is a place online to buy insurance. That's all it is. And it's five different companies that provided it. And what it does is this: we have the lowest insurance rates in the state of Minnesota. I take that back. We have the lowest insurance rates in the nation. We also are the second highest state in the nation that has the most insured people. I tell you what, MinSure has been a good deal. It got off to a slow start, and that was technical reasons. It has not cost us nothing. It's been funded by the federal government, 100% of it. And here's the other thing. You know what? I believe everyone deserves affordable health care. MinSure is one way of that happening.
Jeff?
You know, as an EMT, I agree. We need to do affordable health care, but your facts are off. Big time. I mean, Minnesota is not the lowest. Didn't set a cap. The legislator didn't set a cap. That's why we've seen insurance increases higher in Minnesota than other states. We need to have affordable health care. MinSure is not affordable health care. When you take $400 million and subsidize it because it's not working, and it's more than an online website, it's providing health care. That's what's different. I know families are depending on health care. People are concerned about it. MinSure is much more than an online site. MinSure is a program that has not worked. It has been a catastrophe from the start, and it needs to be changed because one program does not fit all. What we had before was so much better. So we need a better program because we have seen insurance rates go higher, much higher.
Gentlemen, rural water is becoming a pretty significant issue, and of course the federal government does some regulations of rural water. Do you support any type of regulations of water? Jeff?
First of all, the best stewards of our land are farmers. They get it. They get it because obviously if they don't work with work, if it's livestock, if it's their land, it's going to affect not just their business, but other people in the district and so forth. I don't foresee us needing more regulations like what we're seeing coming down from EPA, that they want to regulate even the puddle in the back of our yard. We need to work with what we have. I, as a mayor, worked with Watershed District because of our flooding back there. And we have good stewards, not just in farmers, but in other people in our area already. We do not need more regulations on funding the puddle in our backyard or and so forth. We have things in place already that's reasonable, responsible, and let farmers do what they do best, not the metro area. Unfortunately, right now on the Ag/Environmental Committee, it is ran by people from St. Paul. That does not make sense. Also, stormwater, what we're seeing coming down from stormwater, it's coming from the metro again, that you got to treat stormwater. And out here, that's not the case because we have runoff from ditches and rivers. When the settlers came out here by the Missouri River, I know that's farther in South Dakota, but they called that the Muddy River. You get runoff. You cannot make that water crystal clear. You get that runoff. So we got to have a common sense approach. What we're doing right now is well, and let farmers do what they do well because they're good stewards of the land right now. and water.
Jay?
You know, water has gotten, and I never thought this would ever happen. It's gotten to be a really important issue in Minnesota. I was on a trip down in the southwest part of Minnesota, and we are carrying a pipeline from the Missouri River down into that southwest part of Minnesota because they don't have enough water. You know, we got to be careful with our water resources. And we also got to be able to replenish our aquifers. We got to be able to have clean water. And I think we haven't been as good a stewards as we'd like to have been. And if you go up into Hudson Bay, there's a dead area up in the middle of Hudson Bay. What's it caused by? It's caused by nutrients in the water that's being run up there through our rivers and streams. We need to help have a way to take that those nutrients out. We got to be able to control our rivers, control our waters, replenish our groundwater. And it sometimes has to do with farming practices. And what would be this is I'd like to see cover crops after the crops are taken off, put on, that would hold our soil in place, but also put new roots and holes into the ground from the roots that allow that water to percolate down into our water table, our aquifers. And I was part of a study that helped, I funded a study. It's called Forever Green in Minnesota. And it's good for not only soil, preventing soil erosion, but it's also helping to replenish our aquifers. If we don't get serious about our aquifers, if we don't get serious about our water, we're going to lose it. You know what? That's one resource I never thought would be endangered, and I'm concerned about it.
Jeff, would you like rebuttal?
Yeah, water in Minnesota, we have plenty of it. We are having good stewards right now. From year to year, I talk to farmers, and being mayor, I understand well water, having the aquifer, and we've been level. We do not have a problem with having adequate water. What we have is a problem in Minnesota of one government type from Metro trying to control what we know best in this area. And local control, if it's the watershed district, if it's city council with their aquifers, that's what makes sense. Farmers are good stewards. They are doing good practices with their land. We see that right now. We do not need more regulations saying they have to plant a certain way because they get it. And also the watershed districts and so forth, they get it too. So we don't need more regulations. We got a good resource, and I'm proud of that.
Jay, would you like a rebuttal?
You know, I don't think I get a rebuttal, to be honest with you.
All right. We have another water question.
Okay.
Invasive species are threatening our lakes and rivers. How can you help to protect our lakes and rivers? Jay.
Well, one way is this, is to monitor our boats and stuff that comes in and out of our lakes. Invasive species would be like the milfoil that comes out, that's carried on boats and sometimes in live wells, that, and it would, when it goes from lake to lake, it can spread it around. We need to have people monitoring our areas, and we also got to be good citizens ourselves and make sure if we're taking our boat into a lake that we take and drain our live wells, we take and wash out our boats to protect our lakes. You know, our water in Minnesota is a great resource for us, and we got to protect our lakes, our streams, our rivers, and we all have to do it. And you know what? Tourism is a big business in Minnesota, and we need to protect our water so we can keep that business going.
Jeff?
In regards, we need to be good stewards. I know a lot of people who hunt and fish, and they are good stewards. We have to continue to educate. It's easy for people to get busy with their day-to-day and load up the boat and got to get to, a football game or some type of other event. So we have to continue to educate, and we also have to keep to monitor. I agree, lakes, water is one of our greatest resources that we have in Minnesota, and it does bring people out. With our business, I have the pleasure of talking to people across the country, East Coast and West Coast, down in Texas, Georgia. And that's something that we hear that, you know, wow, Minnesota is so beautiful in the summer, and the lakes you have are just wonderful. And we need to continue to protect that. and continue to be good stewards of what we do and through the education process to prevent those challenges.
Thank you. Jay, do you think changing the way teachers are paid will help improve Minnesota's K through 12 education system?
The way they're paid? I tell you what. I am really concerned about education. And what I'm concerned about is this, is I've been going around and I've been talking to superintendents, and when there's an opening, especially in our rural schools in Minnesota, we don't have many people applying anymore. And the reason we don't have many people applying is that when the kids come out of college, they have such a high debt right now, they can't afford to be teachers. They have to go to places where they can find the most money. You know, one way to change the way we pay them is to pay them more. But I don't know if our local areas can afford that. There's a couple things that teachers do need. And here's what they need to do. They need to have good pensions, and they need to have good health insurance. And we also have to start to look creatively how teachers get hired. In a school district, sometimes if you hire a husband and wife as a team, that will help give them more health insurance and allow them to take more money home. And you know what? Maybe school districts in adjoining areas can work together and hire husband and wife as teams. And we also, it's a real concern. And I'm not real sure what you mean by how we pay them. I do know this. We've got to keep good teachers, and we're losing them now because they're not getting enough compensation. And their insurance is eating them up. We need to provide more things to entice teachers into our rural areas.
Jeff?
We have good teachers in this area. We are very fortunate. I've been going from school and talking to teachers and some superintendents too. And teachers are the lifeblood of our rural communities, school system. One of the easiest way is to lower our income tax. You know, we're the third highest in the state of in the country. We also just saw an increase of $2.1 billion in which those taxes, business to business, which affects teachers and other people because you buy something from businesses. Businesses just can't absorb taxes. So we could do things. Number one, in regards with making it more affordable to live here. Also, what we need to do is allow teachers to do what they do best, and that's teach. You know, right now, we have regulations, unfunded mandates that require teachers to not do what they do best. As a school board member, we see that, and they try really hard. But when you have, like, special ed that has to fill out forms and forms and forms, you know, when that got started many years ago, the forms were like a small tree trunk. Now, it's like a giant tree trunk. And so it's taken away from our students. I know one teacher in our school district who does things on the weekend just so she could stay up with it. So one of the things we have to look at is allowing teachers, just like families, to keep more of their money instead of state government taking money from tax increases like we've seen, being the third highest income tax in the state. And we also need to take the money that the state gives to the school and allow the school board, give them flexibility to reward the good teachers we have instead of a mandate that, you know, you've been here so long, you get X amount of money. Let school boards to be creative.
I'd like to go back to this tax increase. First of all, we raised $2.1 billion worth of taxes, and here's how we did it. We raised 2%, we raised the taxes on 2% of the wealthiest people in our state. That raised $1.4 billion. We closed loopholes for corporations. That raised $400 million. And we added a sales tax to cigarettes, which created $300 million. That's $2.1 billion. That's our increase. It didn't touch a single teacher. It didn't touch a normal Minnesotan. It's the best way to raise taxes. It was the best way to help fund our programs that we needed to fund, such as schools, such as local government aid. It's not what my opponent has been telling is happening.
We must be in a different state because what was raised is 1.12 on business owners, And it went down on individuals, 134,000, I think it was. But what my opponent isn't saying is that $300 million was raised from business to business. Labor, getting work done on your car and other things like that. That affected people. And yes, when you affect business owners, you affect everybody in the economy. It's not like isolated and so forth like a lot of people, like my opponent wants to think. So did that $2.1 billion have a factor on teachers? It did. Whenever you take money from one sector, spread it, give it to someone else, a bureaucracy that's not efficient, wastes money, and then pass it out to another someone else, there's other ways to be more effective. Like I was saying with education, give schools the opportunity to use the money and fund teachers who are successful and so forth.
Thank you, gentlemen. And that actually brings us to the conclusion of the question and answer period. Went kind of fast. Thank you to everyone who called in. We had some great questions, and I'm sorry that we couldn't get through them all. We will now move on to the closing remarks, and each candidate will have 2 minutes for closing remarks. And our closing remarks for the House District 12A candidates will start with Jay McNamar. Jay?
Well, in the past 2 years, I've authored 35 bills for our district in Greater Minnesota. My bills included allocating funds for the West Central Initiative Foundation for business development and expansion in our district, providing funds for the Morris Ethanol Plant to help the plant be more efficient and productive, allocating funds to replace the Cyrus Fire Hall. I carried a bill for $6.2 million for business development and public infrastructure in just Greater Minnesota. I passed a bill that allows our local building inspectors to inspect large projects in our district instead of bringing an inspector in from the metro area at great expense. I carried a bill that eliminated the sales tax on ag equipment repairs and a bonding transportation bill for $54.3 million to help our counties with their roads and their highways. The first bill I had signed into law by Governor Dayton helped every critical access hospital in rural Minnesota, including the 6 critical access hospitals in our district. I carried a finance bill for Otter Tail Power that saved Minnesota Otter Tail Power ratepayers $1 million in 2013 and $1 million in 2014. I'm proud of what I've accomplished with my fellow legislators for our district and Greater Minnesota. Along with these accomplishments, the state is well on its way to recovery from the last recession, creating about 70,000 new jobs and reducing the unemployment rate to 4.3%, the best in years. We made large investments in education, funded our nursing homes, gave a 5% raise to our home and community-based caregivers the first in 6 years. We had a great session, but we cannot be satisfied with what we've accomplished because we have much more to do, such as finding a stable source of funding for transportation, continuing to improve our economy, growing our middle class, funding education, funding nursing homes, reducing our property taxes. It's a big task. We can do it, as long as our legislators keep working together.
Thank you, Jay. Thank you. And now, Jeff Backer, you can have your closing.
Thank you for everybody who watched us tonight. We appreciate that. The main difference between myself and my opponent is I will represent the rural values. My opponent, first of all, voted for tax increase before he voted for a tax cut. He did not support the wishes of the district when it came down to supporting traditional marriage. He does not vote with us. He votes with the metro legislators. I agree. We have to work together, and that's the challenge. When you have a balance of power at St. Paul that's one party, you don't get a balance. What you get is taking $2.1 billion from hardworking middle-class individuals, and we're, you know, my opponent says that it only taxed 2%. Cigarette tax of $1.60 taxed a lot more people and so forth, too. We also had the business-to-business tax that affected the people in our economy. You know, what we need to grow in our area is jobs, not taxes. I hear that at the door. We do need to support our seniors. We do need to support our rural values. And our current representative doesn't do that because he works with the metro people of the DFL. And that's what's going to be different with me. I will support the area. I will do my best to listen to the people and not follow the metro suburbans, because We, unfortunately, in the rural area are getting less, and we need a stronger voice. And that's what I will do as your representative. And again, I would appreciate your vote on November 4th, and thank you for watching tonight.
Thank you, Jeff. That concludes this evening's Meet the Candidates. I hope you've enjoyed the program. Please stay tuned for the next hour when we will meet the candidates for House District 12B, Gordon Wagner from Glenwood and Paul Anderson from Starbuck. And also join us next Wednesday at 7 o'clock when we will go live to the governor's race in Rochester. On behalf of Pioneer Public Television, I'd like to thank the candidates for joining us this evening. Thank the volunteers who have assisted us. But most importantly, I would like to thank you, the viewers, for tuning in and asking your questions and just participating. Remember, your voice is important. Make your voice be heard by voting on November 4th. Thank you.
Thank you for watching Meet the Candidates. We hope that you have gained useful information that will allow you to make an informed decision on Election Day. On behalf of Pioneer Public Television, thank you for watching.